Hey everybody, thanks for joining us here today. Today I am so happy to welcome Joel Wolfson. Hey Joel.
Hey, how you doing, Nicole?
Good. He is here to present Creative Essentials with some of the Topaz plugins. I'll tell you a little bit about Joel first and then we'll hand it over to him. Joel is a Southwest native and has been published internationally. His roster of different clients is pretty exclusive. It includes Newsweek, Elle, 17. He has some corporate clients as well, such as Apple and AT&T, some very cool stuff. He is best known, though, for his more artistic images of different places around the globe. He has also been teaching photography since about 1985, starting at the University of Minnesota. He has conducted digital photography seminars for Apple and other corporations. And he also has presented at national conferences, written articles, and currently is teaching photography workshops and seminars out of his Flagstaff studio, as well as conducting workshops around the world. Definitely check out his website. It's joelwolfson.com if you're interested in any of those workshops. He definitely enjoys sharing the experience and some of his skills with all the participants. So check it out. And with that, I will go ahead and give it over to Joel.
Hey, thanks, Nicole. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the webinar. Thank you all for coming, and special thanks to those of you in faraway time zones who are maybe there very late or very early to hear this. As you know, the title of this thing is Creative Essentials, and what I'm going to do is try to show you the plugins that I find are most universally useful. There are an awful lot of plugins out there, an awful lot of choices, and even when you get within a plugin, there are a lot of different things that you can do with it. So I'm going to show you my workflow, and I've spent a lot of time on these, so hopefully that will save you some time because I'm going to try to show you the controls within these that I think are useful and the ones that have the broadest range of application. Topaz makes a whole bunch of these. I think they have 10 in all, and I use quite a few myself. My bread and butter favorites are Adjust, Black and White Effects, and Detail, and I will show you all three of those today. I also use the Remask and Simplify and sometimes Denoise. So without further ado, I would like to get going on this. The first image here, I shot this in Flagstaff downtown, and a night image. And night images are notoriously difficult because we have a huge range of contrast. And there's little pockets you can see here and down here where it's very dark, and then we have other areas that are very light. And although it's kind of an interesting shot, the way I shot it, it isn't exactly the way I saw it. And to get there, I'm going to show you Adjust. Before I do that, I want to show you sort of the goal of where we're going with this, and that's this image right here. Now, this one I did in Lightroom, and the reason I'm showing you this is because it took me maybe 15 minutes to do this in Lightroom. So certainly, you can accomplish this with Lightroom or with Photoshop. I know Lightroom inside out, and still it took me at least that 15 minutes. What I want to show you with Adjust is how that plugin will accomplish this in probably just 1 or 2 minutes, which is pretty cool. Now, additionally, Topaz is going to be releasing a new version of Adjust, and I'm kind of excited because they gave me a pre-release version that I get to show to you today, and I'm not going to spend time showing you the whole program because we just don't have enough time for that, but I'm certainly going to show you a few things and you'll get a sneak preview. This is where we're starting, and this is about where we want to end up. Now, before I actually launch this thing, since we're talking about efficiency and workflow and essentials here, I'm going to tell you my little rule of thumb. I'm working from within Lightroom. You can also use these plugins in Photoshop and Aperture, and I guess iPhoto as well. My little rule of thumb is if I'm just going to use one plugin, in this case Adjust, I'll just do it from within Lightroom. Topaz makes something called Fusion Express that allows you to use their plugins right from within Lightroom or Aperture. So if I'm going to do more than one plugin, then I would go into Photoshop. And my reason for that is in Photoshop I can do layers, and I can use a plugin for each layer and do multiple layers. And I'll show you that too. Obviously, you have to figure out your own workflow, but this is mine, and I found it to be pretty efficient. So here we go. What I did is I just right-clicked on the image, and I'll bring my mouse down to Edit In. And then we have Topaz Fusion Express. You see above that is my choice for Photoshop, and we'll do that on subsequent images. So I'm going to say let's edit the original, and this will bring us to a menu. And here I'm going to choose Adjust 5. And when that opens, what happens is these plugins will default to wherever they were before. So just to be on the safe side, I'm going to move down to the lower right here where it says Reset All. And I'm going to click on that just to make sure that I haven't applied anything yet. And I'm starting with my basic image the way it was in Lightroom. Now what I want to do, since this is a new program and I'm kind of stoked about it, I'm just going to do a quick overview of this interface. Now those of you that have used Topaz's fairly new black and white effects, also a somewhat new release, you're probably familiar with this interface. It's very, very similar. So I'm going to start on the upper left. You have a thumbnail here, and the purpose of that thumbnail is to give you a quick preview of the presets where my cursor is now. And you see as I mouse over these, like up on high key one, there's high key two, we go to low key, etc., it gives you a quick little preview there. And then if you click on it, of course, it'll apply it to your image. And you notice before, if you had Adjust before this, or you have the current Adjust 4, this, you have this list of presets, but you don't have these collections. They're now divided into collections. There are even more presets, quite a few more. The old standbys from Adjust 4 are in there. And as you go to each collection, it will default to whatever was used last in that collection, which is my reason for going back to this Reset All. Over on the right, there's another thumbnail, which is for navigation. If I click on this and magnify, I can move this red box around to different parts of the image, and it'll show me that part at whatever magnification I'm at. Also, which is kind of neat, is the histogram. So now we have histogram information built into this. And, of course, there are a whole bunch of new controls. And if we have some time, I'll try to show you one or two other of those things. But what I want to do is try to get that image the way we saw it before we came in here. And the first place I'm going to go is to my all-time favorite control, which is adaptive exposure. Adaptive exposure is almost kind of magical the way it works, but it isn't that mysterious. I'll give you an explanation here. What it does is, as I move adaptive exposure over, it's more or less increasing the exposure. But it does it in a truly adaptive way in that it evaluates the contrast as well. So it isn't just, you know, upping the exposure overall and just making it brighter. It's taking into account all the tones of the image. Now, as you can see, as I go up on here, it gets better and better looking. Now, in this, where I am right now, it's starting to bring up the highlights maybe a little too much, and that brings in our second important slider here, and that's regions, and these two work together, adaptive exposure and regions. I'm going to put the regions down to 1 just so I can give you a quick explanation. When it's on 1, it's pretty simple. It treats the image as one piece, as a whole, and so it's doing its best to adjust the exposure based on just the image at looking at it overall. Now this is a difficult image for the exposure here for this adjust because we have all those different pockets of information, light and dark and a huge contrast and a huge range. That's where regions comes in handy. What happens is when I put more regions on there, it just divides it up like a grid. And imagine putting superimposing graph paper over this, and you can do as many regions as you want. So you watch, I just moved that up to 7 regions, and already there's a big improvement. This is an ideal image for using a few more regions. And what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to probably bring the regions up to about 30. And I think that looks pretty good. In fact, we're almost there. So if you take the amount of time I use these sliders, I'm going to move this up just a tiny bit. I just want a little bit brighter. So I moved the sliders, spent maybe all of a minute doing this, and I'm pretty much where I want to be. The only thing that I might change here is on the bottom here, you can see it's a little bit bright. We've equalized the hotel quite nicely, which is, you know, of equal interest, but this is just a little bit bright. Now, in Adjust 4, prior to Adjust 5, I would have gone into Lightroom and darkened that on the bottom using a brush in Lightroom, but guess what? Adjust 5 has it built in. Pretty cool. Whoops, that's the curve tool. Let's go down to local adjustments. That's what I meant to hit here. And in local adjustments, I'll scroll up here. You can see we have these different brushes. And what I'm going to use here is the burn brush. These terms dodge and burn are from wet darkroom days. Those of you that don't have experience in the wet darkroom, that's just what that terminology is. If you want to try to think of a way to remember it, the burn tool, think about burning something in the oven or on the stove, it turns black, so that makes it darker. So I'm going to choose the burn here, and what I'm going to do is move up the strength. Your strength slider goes from 0 to 1, or you can think of it as 0 to 100%. That's kind of the way I like to think of it. So I'm not going to start at full strength. I'm just going to try a little bit. The brush size here, that's pretty self-explanatory. The opacity, I'm going to leave that at 50%. The opacity is the effect that's brushed in as I run the brush across the image. So at 0.5, it's at 50% because the scale goes from 0 to 1. The hardness, that just allows you to feather the edge of your brush just like in Lightroom or Photoshop. I'm not concerned with edges here, so I'm just going to leave that on 0. But just keep an eye on this mask thumbnail down here, and you'll see after I brush in what happens. So I'm just going to go over here, and I'm just going to brush in a little bit darker exposure to bring down the streak. And you can see the thumbnail of the mask shows you where I've made the effect. Now you can see whatever's black is blocked out, whatever's white shows through or has the effect applied, and the effect is applied just where I did it here. Now, I overshot a little bit, and that's really no problem here, because what I can do is go up to the eraser, and now it'll erase what I did, and I don't really want to go much above that line, and that's just about right. So I think we're pretty much done here. When I say OK, it's going to apply everything we just did, and it should save it right back into Lightroom. And I'll probably take a second for it to redraw, and there we go. Now what I'm going to do is let's compare it with the one that I did before. Takes a second for the compare, and what I'll do is I'll make it a little bigger so you can see it easier. Now on the right, we have the one I did in Lightroom, which like I say, took me at least 15 minutes. The one on the left, if you add up the time, and all I used was the sliders in adaptive exposure, and I also used the brush tool, and that was it. And the whole thing was maybe 1 or 2 minutes, and I even like it better. If you look at these two, you know, they're both good, but I actually like the way Adjust did it better. To me, the color balance is a little nicer, actually. So, and I didn't spend nearly as much time. So the other thing I want to do here, you know, we've got this final image, looks pretty nice, but I think I'm going to spend just like a minute here and go back in to show you another part of Adjust 5 that I think is pretty cool. So I'll go back into Fusion Express. We're going to say edit the original. And I'm going to go into Adjust 5. Now I'm going to reset all. And now our starting point is where we finished the image before. And the reason I wanted to bring this back in and mention this is this apply button. This apply button is pretty cool because it allows you to stack effects right from within Adjust 5. Previously, I could save something off, bring it back in, apply another effect, and save it off, and so forth. Well, now I can stack all those effects. And they've got some pretty cool presets in here. So I'm going to go to, I think it's already on high key. I'm going to go to high key here. I'm going to apply that. Now, I probably, with this image, wouldn't use high key the way it is, but the reason I did that is I want to stack another preset on top of that. And I'm going to go to one of my favorites here, which is Stylized Collections. And this one, which is called Dark Charcoal, and you can see it in the thumbnail as I mouse over it. And by combining these two, I get a pretty cool effect. Now, if we want to see a side-by-side, there's also this side-by-side window built in there that shows you left and right. And if you do magnify, you can navigate around there to see the details. So there we go. You got a quick peek at Adjust 5, and you saw how we optimized a pretty difficult image in a very short amount of time. So for the next image here, we're going to add another plug-in to the mix. I'm going to do this portrait right here. Now, Nicole mentioned that we do workshops in Italy, and when I was scouting for one of them, I ran across this guy working on his Fiat and started talking to him in my terrible Italian, and I just really liked his face, just real intriguing, and he said it was okay if I took some photos of him, so I did, and this was one of my favorite picks. Now, I'm going to magnify in, and I should mention this whole time that I was shooting this day, I was doing everything with the intention of black and white. Now, if you're shooting raw, which is what I recommend doing, whether you're shooting color or black and white, it's really going to take, your camera's going to shoot a color image. And so I knew this was going to be black and white, so I'm going to be showing you black and white effects. But I just wanted to zoom in to show his face because it's got an awful lot of character, and that's what we're going to try to bring out. So additionally, I'm going to be using Topaz's detail, and that's because detail has allows you to fine-tune controls of any type of detail and sharpness, small, medium, and large, and there's a couple sliders for each one of those. So we're going to use two of those, and because of that, like I mentioned before, we're going to go into Photoshop so that we can put each one in a layer. So we'll open this in Photoshop, and there we are. And these are going to be pretty simple adjustments. This is for a more or less straightforward black and white portrait. So the first thing I do before I go into black and white effects is I'm going to duplicate my background. The background is the main photo layer. Over here in the layers palette on the right, if you don't already know this shortcut in Photoshop, you can click and drag this layer down to the little dog ear icon, which is the layer icon, and it'll duplicate the layer. Now, I'm a big fan of labeling things. I'm going to double click on that, and I'm going to call this black and white effects so that I know what I did in that layer if I want to go back to this. So now to invoke black and white effects or any of the Topaz plugins, we go over to the filter menu, click on that, go down to Topaz, and there's black and white effects. Now when that opens, it looks kind of dull. Again, it was probably using whatever was done in there last. It defaults to the last few settings, so we're going to go back to that reset all, and that gives me more or less a neutral grayscale image. And it's not bad, but I could improve upon it. And again, I'm going to go back to my friend here, which is the adaptive exposure. And if I just want to mention, if you take a look at this, the interface is just pretty much the same as Adjust 5. So it's a nice consistent interface. I can show that little preview thumbnail if I were to go through and check out some of these presets. But I have a pretty good idea what I want to do here, and that's basically just add some contrast with adaptive exposure. Let's start the slider all the way to the left so that you can see the effect here. And I'm just going to bring this up. Oh, let's go to about 25. And that's getting there. What I want to do is I'm going to zoom in a little bit here. And this way what I can show you is if I take off, whoops, I lost my adaptive exposure. We'll go back up to 25. All right, what I want to show you is these little check boxes are really handy. You know that we have the normal before and after, so there's where we started and there's where we are now. and we have the split screen as well. However, you can isolate an individual effect. So with this over to 25, I can check my adaptive exposure just by unchecking that box. So there's before and there's after. And that looks really good. It's a subtle difference, but I'll uncheck this again. If you look, this is a little bit on the flat side. There's not a lot of depth, doesn't draw us in as much. And just with that small change in the adaptive exposure, we get a lot more depth here. Now I'm going to be working more on bringing out the character of his face, but before I go into detail to do that, there's one more little tool. And I'm just going to add a little more contrast here. It's just a little bit on the low contrast side for me. And if you notice, I just opened the curve tool, which is in the same section, conversion. And the curve tool is just like the curve tool in Photoshop or in Lightroom. And it allows you to have a little more precise control over your contrast than just the contrast slider. I mean, if the contrast slider works for you, great. If you want to have a little more control, you can use this curve here. For those of you that aren't familiar, we start with pure black on the left, pure white on the right, and every shade of gray in between. And we can change it by altering the line. So I'm in the darker areas here. I'm going to click just before the line and bring down those values just a little bit, and then do the same thing in the highlights in the other direction. It gives us a very gentle S curve. And essentially what that did is added some more contrast. Again, I can double check this. Click that box. That's before the curve tool. That's after the curve tool. I am going to bring down the highlights just a hair. And I like that the way it looks. And before we go into detail now, I'm going to zoom this in just so you can see his face so you know where we're starting. Okay, so we're all done here. I think this looks great. I do want to mention something about looking at this at 1:1. That's great for scrutinizing your detail. I like to use 50% to get an idea of scrutinizing a print. Now, you can't duplicate how a print looks exactly on the screen, but 1:1 isn't very realistic when you're examining a print. That would be the equivalent of being about a nose distance from it, a very large print, and we normally look a little more comfortable viewing distances than that. So I like using that 50%. So I'm going to say okay, and that's going to save our effects. So there's where we started with our color, a little on the flat side. We have a lot more dynamic black and white now, and I'm just going to add to the character of his face by using detail. I'm going to duplicate that layer like I showed you before. I'm going to relabel this detail, and oops, detail too. We go to the filter menu again, go down to Topaz Labs. We're going to go into detail. And this is going to analyze the image. And the first thing we're going to do, if you all remember, is once it's done here, is reset all just to make sure we're at kind of a neutral point. So one way to double check that is go up here to the upper left, click on original. Shortcut to that is using the space bar. So by clicking original preview, I can ensure that I'm back to the where I started when I open this. And let's just zoom in a little bit, because what we're really concerned with here is this guy's face. So what we want to do is just add some more depth to this. And the detail in his face is pretty fine, so we're going to use the small detail. Now, if you've seen the detail control on some of the other plugins like Adjust or Black and White Effects, there's just one detail slider and a detail boost. Here we have six sliders, so we can really tweak it. And here we're basically just going to work with the small detail. And what I'm going to do is just boost this up. And there's a very subtle difference there, and where I get a little more is the small boost will emphasize the weaker fine detail as opposed to just the fine detail with this. So we have two sliders for the fine detail. I'm going to move this up just a little bit too. Maybe go a little more there and a little more there. And I think we're pretty close. I'm going to back off my small boost just a hair. So I think that looks pretty good, and I want to do a before and after for you. there's before, and still the man has an intriguing face. He probably doesn't appreciate me increasing the depth of his wrinkles. However, he's got that beautiful character in his face, and it is looking a little exaggerated here at 1:1, but remember, when you're looking at a print, a final print, you're not going to be able to scrutinize it this closely. It's going to be a little bit more like 50%. So if we do a before and after, it's going to look a little more subtle at the 50%. There's the before, and there's the after. And I think we have a really nice looking portrait. So I'm going to say OK. And there we are. So if you want to look at where we started, that's where we started. We added black and white effects, gave us a really nice conversion, and then we added the detail. Here's before detail and after. So there we are. Two plugins, not a whole lot of time, basically just used a couple of sliders in each of those and ended up with a really, really nice, rich black and white with a lot of depth that really draws you in, I think, compared to the sort of flat-looking color thing that we started with. So now we're going to add even more to this mix here, and we're going to use three plugins now, and I'm going to go again to a completely different type of image, a landscape. Now this comes up and everybody goes, huh? Okay, it's a little bit dull looking, I admit. And believe it or not, I shot it this way. And the reason I shot it this way, here I'm going to make it a little bigger so you can see all that wonderful washed out sky. So you may ask why I shot it this way. Most DSLRs, modern digital cameras, will hold a lot of information. And they hold a lot more, certainly, than you can see on the LCD. And by the way, don't trust your LCD on the back of your camera, because that is based on a JPEG and not a RAW file. And it's only an approximation at best of what your image is going to look like. But even on a monitor, it doesn't look like there's much detail here. So what I'm going to show you is I'm going to first go into the develop module of Lightroom. We're going to do a couple adjustments there because that allows us to work on the RAW file. And then we're going to go after that into adjust, and then detail, and then black and white effects. So my final goal here is a black and white. This is what I planned when I shot this. In fact, it was during a black and white workshop that I was teaching. So the first thing we're going to do is bring down the exposure a little bit, and you can already see some detail coming back into this thing. And the other thing I'm going to do is leave the recovery slider at 100. I just want to show you this. There's zero recovery. This is a neat feature in Lightroom. It allows you to bring back detail that you don't see in your highlights. I almost said that you lost, but you haven't really lost it. It's there. So this is a starting point, and the reason I'm doing this is I'm trying to darken this, essentially get the exposure to a point where I don't lose detail in this rock, which is the darkest part. And you can see with this magnifier cursor over this part of the image, it gives me a readout in the upper right-hand side up here in percentage, and I don't want that to be zero. And likewise with the sky, I don't want it to be 100 or it'll be blown out. So I got this to a point where I have detail, or at least information at my two extremes. And what we're going to do is take the image and go into Photoshop and put in our different adjustments through the Topaz plugins. Close out my old one there of the mechanic guy. And the first thing we're going to do is go into adjust. Now, you might ask, why would I use adjust when I have a color image? And the answer is that I have found that if you make a color image a bit gaudy looking, basically too contrasty and too saturated for what you would normally do for a color image, it'll convert better to black and white. Just a quick note here, side note, is that I did my top 10 black and white tips and techniques. You can get to it from my website. And this is one of them where I talk about making it a little gaudy beforehand. It's on my website under the, I believe it's under favorites, and Topaz has it on their website as well. So again, I'm going to probably use the adaptive exposure. Now this is an area where I might start with actually one of my favorite presets for landscape, which is Photo Pop over on the left here. These are the presets. We talked about those before. And that's a pretty good starting point. And if you just look at where we started, I mean, just that minor difference, I mean, it makes a big difference just with that preset. And I'm going to enhance on that too. Now this is, I'm using this as a starting point. I'm going to turn off the details because we're going to use details separately. So I'm going to bring up the adaptive exposure here even more. Oh, probably 50-ish or something like that. And look at that. We've already got a lot more contrast. We've brought up the shadows. We haven't lost our highlight detail. The sky is already more vivid. And about the only other thing I'm going to do to this to add a little of that extra contrast. Now, this might even be approaching something you would print in color, but we remember, we want to kind of overdo it a little bit. So I'm going to add a little bit more saturation to this. I'll bring it to about 25 there. And now it's starting to look a little crazy, a little oversaturated, and that's great because we're going to be converting it to black and white, and that'll actually help us. I think the regions are good where they are. So now we have this almost gaudy looking, kind of oversaturated and maybe a little contrasty image, and it should work out pretty well. I'm going to say okay, we're done with the adjust part of it. And now I just want to point out something here. Some of you that were really paying close attention probably noticed that previously I was always making a separate layer here, an additional layer to work on so that I don't disturb my original layer. You notice Topaz Adjust 5, and I'm going to label this too, does automatically make a new layer for you if you check that option in the preferences. It's kind of a little thing, but it's kind of handy. I am, however, for detail, going to make another thing here. Now, what I'm going to do with detail, let me explain this. I'm going to use detail just for the sky. So this is something that I found that works pretty well, and applying detail, normally we think of detail as sharpening and bringing out the detail on an image, but what I'm going to work on is just the sky for this. So I go into filter, back in here, we'll go to detail, and it's analyzing the image here. The color looks a little off, but I'll do my reset all once we're done here. So I'll reset it, and we can double check ourselves, and our original preview look the same, so we're where we left off coming out of adjust. Now I'm going to magnify this, and I think what I'll do is go to about 50%. Now I'm leaving a little bit of that rock and a little bit of that tree in the window so that you can see what happens to those. And you have to stretch your imagination here a little bit in terms of pre-visualizing black and white. Now when I shot this thing, you guys don't have the benefit of remembering what the sky looked like, but I did. And so the hard part when you're doing something like this is to just mentally focus on just the sky. And we'll take care of the fact that we're probably going to end up with too much detail in the rest of it otherwise. And what I'm going to do here for the detail is work on the medium detail, because really we're just worried about the clouds. We're not worried about fine detail here. So I'm going to bring the medium detail up, 40-ish maybe. And that looks fairly subtle. We're going to boost that a little bit with the boost. And this is like the boost in the small detail. It brings up the weaker medium detail. So I'll bring that up a little bit too. Okay. Now, let's look at the before. There it is. And the clouds look pretty cool. And there's the after. There's a little bit more definition to them. So we're approaching where I want to be with those clouds. However, if you take a look at this rock on the left here, there's probably an awful lot of extra detail. And if I go down to the brush, it's a bit overdone on the detail. But we will take care of that when we get back into Photoshop. What we're really concentrating on here is the sky. Now, I'm going to even go a little more with the sky. I'm going down to the tone menu here, and what I'm going to do here is you see you have all the basic colors and their complements, red, yellow, and blue, magenta, cyan, and green. And so they're paired with opposites, cyan, red, magenta, green, yellow, blue. So what I'm going to do is take out yellow and add blue, and so this will pop the sky a little bit. And there we are. So I've popped the sky a little more, and now it's really, I know the color is rather gaudy and not that realistic, but I don't care because I'm going into black and white, and the sky is now starting to look the way I remember this thing. And we are going to have to take care of that sort of over-detailed rock and brush. So I'll say okay. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to add a mask. Over on the right, I'm in the layers palette. Over on the right, there's this little icon. It says add layer mask if you mouse over it, so I'm going to click on that. And nothing happened, and it shouldn't, because I just have a blank mask. But what the mask does, just like we did in black and white effects, I guess it was Adjust 5, is it allows us to mask out parts of the image. So we do that by using a brush in Photoshop, so I'll go over and get the brush. Now, the key here is you want to make sure that you're on black, because black is going to block out things. It masks it out. So the way I do that is on the lower left here, just make sure the black is in the foreground. It even says set foreground color. If it's not, you can click on this little icon here, the small one, and that sets it to default, and then reverse them so that you have black in the front. And I think I'll just use a little bit bigger brush here. Now watch this as I go across here. It should come through on your screen there. I can see it fairly easily here. As I brush across here, I'm decreasing the detail. Okay, in this rock, and I want to go right over to that brush over there on the side. Brushing the brush, kind of like that. I think it's rabbit brush for those of you that are plant aficionados. And so you can see in the little thumbnail of the mask, that was the shape I blocked out. Now, so now I have all that great texture in the sky, and for in case you're worried that I brushed out too much detail, by brushing out that detail, I'm just going to zoom in here so you can see there's actually plenty of detail in there, and it's a little bit more realistic than it was before. So now we're done with adjust, and we're going to need to make another layer. So I'm going to show you another little Photoshop trick here, and that is, instead of just duplicating this detail layer, which has a mask that I'll have to deal with, I really want to combine all three of these. And if you hold down the Option key on a Mac, Alt key on a PC, and you go up into the menu here, and you do Merge Visible, it will merge all those layers and throw it into a new one. So there's our new layer, which is a combination of all of them. And our last step here is to make it a black and white. So we're going to go into Black and White Effects and turn this into a black and white. So filter, Topaz, black and white effects. And we've done most of the work already. I'm going to reset all to bring us back to a neutral. So I'm just going to do a couple little things in this to bring it back to where I want it for black and white. So here's in the conversion menu. Now, these are designed for top-down, meaning you usually go down in order. But a lot of times with black and white, I skip right to the color filter first. And this is a lot like using a colored filter in black and white film. If you ever shot film, landscape photographers would often use a red filter. Now, I moved, this slider has all the colors, and I moved it to the all the way to the left, which is red. And the strength starts out at 50. I'm going to move it all the way up. Now remember, we have these little check boxes, so if you want to see the effect of this, I can check it. There's before the red filter, and there's after the red filter. Now, that's looking pretty good. I would like to see just a hair more drama in that sky, and my red filter is maxed out, so I'm going to go into color sensitivity, and here we have, remember, this plug-in is working on the color information behind the scenes. So wherever there is a blue tone, for instance, in the sky, I can adjust that. So if I move it to the left, I can darken this a little bit. Let's try just a tiny bit there. So there's before my color sensitivity change, there's after. It's almost a little too much. I'm going to back it off just a little bit. So there's my before, there's my after. And the only thing I have left to do, I think it's starting to look really great. We've got a lot of contrast in there. If you remember where this thing started, which I'll show you when we come out of here, it's come a long way. Remember that washed out image? So the thing that happened here is I'm going to use the split screen to show you this. And that is, if you look in our black and white image, there's no separation now between this brush and this piece of lava rock here. And if you look at the color image, there's plenty of separation, but it's pretty much reds and greens, and they register as the same tone of gray in a black and white image. So we need to fix that. Fortunately, we have our handy dandy little tool in here, local adjustments, which allows us to brush it out. So I'm going to use, in this case, I'm going to use the dodge brush. That's going to make it a little bit lighter to just give us some separation. So I'll set my brush size, feather it a little bit, and I think for the overall strength here, I'll probably bump it up just a little bit. And my opacity's probably okay, somewhere in there. And I'm just going to brush it in. Maybe just a little bit right there. So now we've got a little separation. Now the cool thing about this a local adjustment, both in adjust and in black and white effects, is you can redo the strength afterwards. So I can bring that all the way down to where it was. I can bring it way up, almost looks like infrared there. But I think we want some separation, but we don't want to overdo it. So now we have some nice separation. You can see the triangle shape of this lava rock, the triangle shape of this pine tree, and the triangle shape and the pattern of the clouds, which is really what this composition was all about to begin with. And voila, you've got a pretty nice looking black and white landscape. Now I just want to go back and show you where all this started. That's what we started with. It's kind of amazing what we did with just three plugins here. We really fine-tuned it. You know, here was our adjust where we wanted that gaudy look to get the black and white conversion. We added more detail we just used it for the sky here. And this is kind of a good example to see how that masking works. It basically just changes the sky with the before and after. And then we put it into black and white effects, and there we are. We got a great black and white landscape. So there you are, three of my favorite plugins on three different types of images. And that's it. I'm going to turn it over to Nicole for questions.
That's awesome. Thank you so much. That was a beautiful conversion, by the way.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
We have tons of questions coming through, a lot about your personal workflow and some technical questions. So I'll just go ahead and start it off. And if anybody has any personal questions for Joel, you can type them into his questions module now. All right, so my first question comes from Leonard, who is asking a more technical question. He just wanted to know if you're using a pen and tablet or if you're just using the mouse when doing the selective adjustments within Topaz Adjust.
Well, I do use a tablet. It allows me a little more precision when I'm really working hard on an image. You know, for demonstration purposes, I might use the mouse. And you know, for some things you can use a mouse, but I do recommend a tablet, especially when you're doing selective adjustments, whether it's in Topaz Adjust, black and white effects, or even Lightroom or Photoshop. I really like, I just like the feel of using the stylus. So I do recommend that.
The next one comes from Julie, and she has a general question for you. Where do you offer workshops other than your Flagstaff area?
Hi, Julie. Thanks for asking. We literally do them all over the world. So although my studio is based in Flagstaff and we do offer several in Southwest locations, since this is kind of my backyard and I've spent many years here backpacking and hiking and shooting in the little nooks and crannies in the Southwest, and it's a good location. We have lots of, you know, national monuments, national parks around here. The one we just did of the lava rock is 10 minutes from my studio, and other than Hawaii, it's the only place I've seen lava fields like that. And we have the Grand Canyon, Bryce, Zion. There's all kinds of stuff right near to us if you want an excuse to come to the Southwest. we also do them in Italy. We have an annual one in Italy and in France. And for those of you that want something more customized, we also do private guiding and private workshops and semi-private workshops. So if you look at our workshop schedule on the website, and it doesn't fit your schedule or you don't see exactly what you're looking for, just email me or call or whatever, and we can always set up something either semi-private or custom for you.
Okay, thanks for that information. Robert asks, when you're out shooting, do you find yourself thinking about how your shot will look once you've processed it with Topaz or any other processing, or do you not worry about that when you're out shooting?
You know, Robert, that's a really good question. And I would say the honest answer is sometimes I do and sometimes I don't. I certainly do a lot. I know that's not very precise, is it? I do a lot of pre-visualization with black and white. And now that we have all these tools for digital, like Adjust and the various plugins that are out there, I do occasionally think about that. I am really kind of an advocate of doing as much as you can in the camera. And that just saves you some time later. And then I like to leave the plugins for either special effects or overcoming sort of the technical shortfalls of our equipment or the whole process. And that last one I did is kind of a good example. It looked really bland the way I shot it, but I actually metered everything from the sky to that lava rock and everything in between with all the different tones and zones. It was about a 5 f-stop range, and so knowing that I couldn't, I could hold it with the camera with a raw image, but I couldn't represent it without doing something to it. I guess I knew ahead of time that I would be doing some work on it on the computer for sure, and I just adjust. And black and white effects, more namely the adaptive exposure, is great for that kind of thing where you have a landscape with a huge broad range. I think Ansel Adams would love to have adaptive exposure.
Nice. Okay, I have a couple other technical questions real quick. Brad is asking about JPEG versus RAW. He says he still is using JPEG and wants to know what your thoughts are on using RAW and if there's any benefit to it.
Brad, that's a real good question, and I get asked that fairly often. The short version is RAW is better. Now, that said, basically the difference is with JPEG, your camera is doing most of the processing. And with RAW, you have to do the post-processing. So what you saw me do, for instance, with that image to prepare it in Lightroom, that was some very minor adjustments. But your RAW images come out looking, even under the best of circumstances, they're a little bit flat and they need a little work. So it just depends. There is an argument for shooting JPEG if you're a photojournalist, you've got a tight deadline, you're shooting a football game, you got to get those images, you know, out there within 30 minutes of the game ending or whatever, you're going to shoot JPEG and get that stuff uploaded because you don't have time to use Lightroom or Aperture or Photoshop and adjust those raw images. But if you have the time at all or the option, you definitely want to use RAW because there's a lot more information there. That thing we did with the sky, in that last image, you just would not be able to do with a JPEG because JPEG would approximate what was in the sky, and I've run into that situation before, and it just doesn't, the detail is just gone because JPEG is a compression scheme, and it literally throws out information. So right off the bat, you're probably losing maybe 20% of your information with JPEG. I know that sounds awful, but JPEG does work well for a lot of things, and you can probably on your camera, Brad, is set it to shoot both JPEG and RAW until you have time to work with this and decide whether or not you want to shoot just RAW or go back to shooting JPEG.
Okay, great. Talking more about processing, Peter wants to know what personally is the first thing you find yourself correcting when you are starting the post-processing workflow in an image?
That is also a good question. I virtually always start in Lightroom. That's my, what I would call my workflow hub, and I think it is a great hub for workflow. And the first thing I would probably do with my image is white balance. Now, when you shoot raw, the white balance that you set on your camera will show up in Lightroom or Aperture or whatever you're using. It'll show up as a starting point, but you're not locked into it, as opposed to JPEG where it's a lot more critical. So if you're shooting raw and you're opening it in Lightroom, it's going to come up with whatever white balance you had set. So if you accidentally had set it on tungsten and you were outdoors and it was all blue, it's very easy to correct that. So my first thing is usually to tweak the white balance to where I think it should be. And then I go on to things like the exposure if it needs a little tweak, recovery. I'm a big fan of mid-tone contrast. Almost every image needs it. In Lightroom, that would be the clarity slider. You can also do those things like you saw. If you're going to go into the Topaz plugins, you can use the adaptive exposure is really great for that too. I don't know if I mentioned this, but I kind of call adaptive exposures a little bit like the fill light on steroids. So it's kind of a combination of controls that you would have to do in another program with sort of one or two easy sliders in the plugin. So I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, I think it definitely does. We had a couple people asking, should they be working with their images at their output resolution size, or should they be working with a larger size and then go down to their output resolution? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, that's also a very good question. It is somewhat situational, but what I would say is that you want to keep your image in RAW as long as you can. So if you're using something that has parametric editing, which simply means non-destructive, like Lightroom or Aperture, or even Adobe Camera RAW from within Photoshop, you want to do probably as many adjustments as you can with those, keeping efficiency in mind. That first example I showed is a good example in that I spent a lot of time in Lightroom trying to get that image where I wanted it, and it only took a minute or two in adjust. So, of course, when I go to adjust, I'm committing it to a TIFF, but I actually got my result a lot faster that way, and in my opinion, a little bit better. So I hope that sort of answers your question about using it at that. I don't like to res down until I have to. That's the bottom line, is I wouldn't go down to your output resolution until you're ready. And that way you can have kind of a master file, because what happens is if you take your raw file and you scale it down, let's say you're doing a smaller print, maybe an 8x10, and you scale it down and you do all this work on it, then you're kind of locked into that and you'd have to do it over again if you go to a bigger image. So if you try to do all your work on what I would call a master file, so that could be your RAW file if you can do everything from within Lightroom, but if you bring it into Photoshop and use some plugins and that sort of thing, you'll probably have a TIFF file or maybe a Photoshop PSD file. I still wouldn't res it down. I'd leave it at the native resolution, and then that will be your master file, and then you generate iterations from that. And that I find to be the best workflow, both for efficiency and for quality.
All right.
I hope that answers that one.
Yes, it definitely does. Christoph, I'm not sure if that's how the name is pronounced, but would like to know if you feel that Topaz kind of opens up a different part of your brain, more for the play type of, do you find yourself just playing around with Topaz products, if it's easier that way?
actually, I love that question, Christoph, or however you pronounce your name. But yeah, that is a great question, and yes is the answer. It my brain does operate a little differently. You know, we all tap into both the left and right brain when you're talking about photography, because it's that interesting combination of both technical and artistic. And what I would say is it kind of depends what I'm doing too, because I just have an awful lot of fun with those presets. And you know, maybe you heard my voice get more excited when I did, when I was showing you that that apply button where you can stack the different presets on top of each other. That just makes it kind of quick and easy to explore a lot of different creative possibilities. And I'm a big fan of exercising that part of your brain and, you know, using the Topaz plugins and the presets and just playing around with the controls is one way to do it. Obviously, you know, look at as much artwork as you can. I mean, I find inspiration from, you know, painting and other art forms as much as I do photography, and certainly, you know, visit art museums and do all you can in addition to playing with those presets.
Okay. I forgot to write down the name of who asked this. They asked it a little bit earlier. Do you use Remask? And if so, do you find it to be easy to use?
Yes, I do use Remask. I really like it. The kind of masking I do is usually to isolate a subject. I know that's kind of what Remask is for, but if I noticed on the Topaz tutorials that you guys have, you know, there's a lot of stuff with translucency showing, like wedding veils and things like that. It really is versatile, and it handles those difficult types of subjects. If you actually, you know, if you look at my blog, I showed one there with an aspen tree that I masked, and I tried masking that in Photoshop. I tried it in Lightroom, and it was just worked really, really well and really easily with Remask. So I really do like Remask. That is, I don't use that as often, say, as Adjust, but when I need to mask something, that is my go-to plugin.
With that, I think we're going to go ahead and end the webinar. Joel, thank you so much for sticking around to answer some more questions. I really appreciate it, and I know everybody else does as well.
Well, you're very welcome, and all of you that stuck around, thank you very much.
Thanks, everybody.